In his book on deep survival, I mean, Shackleton's Ways is a great book to read for survival. But another book on deep survival by Lawrence Gonzalez, he talks about who survives in a forest when they're lost. And it turns out that only people with a lower IQ and children below the age of 6 have greater chances of survival than older people and even children above the age of 7, right? So, and the older people, why do children survive better? Simply because children go by instinct, right? And older people try to create their own mental maps. They try to guess what will happen, from where will the people come to save him. And they go on without water or without eating whatever is available, and then suddenly they find that they are in trouble and they just die of hunger or thirst or something. Why does this happen? Because they go into the forest without the tools, without the maps, without the aids which are needed. I have seen people getting into a run immediately after a long flight without understanding the impact of jet lag. In fact, in one of the runs which I ran, that guy collapsed at the end and died. He was working for a big IT company. End of the run, he collapsed, and doctors afterwards, we came to know, that had said that he was sleep deprived. Why does a person be sleep deprived? Overconfidence that my body, nothing will go wrong. We heard, when we had gone to Ladakh, we had heard of two people who had come, one from Germany, one from Israel, two good runners. They landed in Ladakh, in Leh, and they were told to take rest, but they didn't. And in the afternoon, they went for a run, and both died that night. Acclimatization, adjusting to mountains, we just are overconfident. We think we know everything about our body. We don't. So many things about our body we don't know. I met a bunch of heart surgeons, and they told me that every year, I mean, they sit and talk, laugh every day and saying, oh, one patient had come, he actually had gas trouble, but he thought it was heart trouble and he came, it was just a waste of time and things like that. And he said, among our friends who are heart surgeons, every 2-3 years we lose one who thought it was gas trouble, but it turned out to be a heart trouble, right? Confidence. Where can confidence come from? You never know. Overconfidence, you never know. Keep checking your ego, because your ego tells you you know everything while you don't. We underplay the role of luck, like what Taleb would say. So why do kids survive? Because kids just go by instinct. They know that when they have to get warm, they hide inside a tree and they get some warmth. Whenever they find berries, they eat, they drink water, and after 2-3 days, they are found. Whereas older people just give up, saying, oh, nothing can be done, or they walk across to a cliff and they try climbing down or something foolish and they die, right? So what can you do to make sure that you understand? One thing you understand, and it is very nice to be on social media and on Twitter, to realize how half knowledge can be very dangerous. So some people will come and talk to you about, I mean, people who do not know how to calculate yield will be talking to you about dividend-based investing. And dividend-based investing is good only if the price of the share holds, right? So, digressing, but overconfidence comes from a little knowledge. A little knowledge is a dangerous thing, and we all know it. We all heard it in the past. And there is enough evidence now to collect and say, okay, a little knowledge is dangerous. For example, at some stage you feel, oh, this share is fully priced. You have no clue. Or you feel this share is very poorly priced. Then you buy. Again, you have no clue, right? So who has done enough research on this? Obviously, Dunning and Kruger have found, they found that a small amount of knowledge is a particular domain. That guy's confidence soared. And as he got more and more knowledge, he realized that he was wrong. So when I was young, maybe about 30 years ago, I had a head full of black hair and foolish ideas. The hair has turned white. I hope the foolish ideas have become less foolish. Less foolish, I don't give advice to people. I have the right to lose my own money, but I don't have the right to lose other people's money in direct equity, right? So if a fund manager loses money, that's bad luck, because I thought I had gone to a good fund manager and that's it. But direct equity, I am taking responsibility. I am trying to tell you this is a good share, it will do well. I have invested my money, but I have invested my money is my problem, not his problem, right? And I may have invested 3% of my money. He may have invested 60% of his money. Therefore, so you start by saying, oh, I know everything about equity. My father was investing in equity, so I know everything. You start from there. Then you read more and more of the Morgan Housels of the world and you say, oh, I should just be indexing. Why am I doing anything else? So somewhere caught between here, I am Buffett and I can create alpha to I am Morgan Stanley and I just need to put money in an index fund. Somewhere in between the tug of war, depending on whether Buffett is stronger or Morgan Housel is stronger, we all settle somewhere in between. I don't know anybody who is a pure indexing person or a person who is completely only into stock picking. He'll do stock picking, he'll also be in equity funds. I'm one such case. I have index funds, I have regular funds, I have direct equity, and in the last couple of years at least index funds have done well. But I still believe that a large cap fund with a good fund manager can create alpha. So I'm not clearly either on Buffett's side or on Morgan Housel's side, but yeah, somewhere halfway in between. How do you keep controlling your so another person, another good person to read is of course Zweig's, Z-W-E-I-G, Jason Zweig. He's got a blog, so go and find out and read about it. And he talks about how your mind, I don't remember the book offhand, how your mind is your enemy or things like that. That's his book, but you can go and read on his blog. Of course, some of his new posts are only available in Washington Post, but yeah, that's another person. And almost every big failure comes from overconfidence, whether it is Suzlon. I met the promoters. Promoter is good, but somewhere he got overconfident. Subiksha, again, terrible overconfidence, thinking that he can take the whole world for a ride. Every big company you see, every small company you see, which has gone downhill very fast. I'm sure somewhere Anil Ambani also thought that I can handle this much of debt and more and things like that, but he came crashing, right? So overconfidence is a big killer. Your greatest example, of course, is long-term capital management. Then most of the dot-com bubbles were all run by small, young entrepreneurs. They all failed. All of them, some people came and said, oh, I know everything there is about investing. The most important thing about investing is to say it works in the long run. You need small incremental changes. You have to take care of your health and make sure that you live long enough for compounding to work for you, right? So whether it is good, the most important thing, like I would think, is good health. But apart from that, if you have never felt overconfident while doing taking a decision or by asking people who are overconfident or who are fully confident and still gone wrong, welcome to the world. And if you have never, if you don't admit and you have really not failed, then be ultra extra careful because one day you will fail. So whenever you take a decision, whether let's say you take a decision to buy Tata Power or Tata Motors, think hard about it. Think what is happening. Why is it happening? Why Tata Power look good at 30 rupees? Why Tata Motors look good at 50 rupees or 52 rupees? I'm talking of the DVR. Think hard. See what the chairman said. See what happened. Read about it. Talk about it. Talk to some analysts if you can. If you can't talk to an analyst, go and read the company's balance sheet. Check out what is happening. See how much time you took over the decision. Sleep over it for a night. And then you still feel confident. Then go and buy. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be thinking fast, thinking slow. Don't have to do thinking fast. You can do your thinking slow. Ask people who hate the Tata Group. Ask people who hate Mukesh Ambani why Reliance is a good buy or a good sell. Ask the guys buying the shorts, right? Question everything. Why will everybody go and buy only Ambani's products? Why will everybody go to Jio Mart? What will happen if people don't go? Does it mean Bharti and Vodafone will shut down, right? Keep on asking, probing. Because if you take big mutual funds like Templeton Mutual Fund, I put more money in Bharti than in Reliance. Companies like mutual funds like HDFC have put money in both. ICICI has put money in both. Very few people have bet against Ambani. If yes, there are some people who have bet against Ambani. There are people who say, no, it's over diversified. I don't understand the balance sheet, so I will not buy. So find out all that. Diversify. Lage raho. Keep doing SIPs over long periods of time. This will at least reduce your overconfidence and improve your returns. थैंक यू।